grace is found in the faith we sing, number 2268. He sent his adaptation of the Articles of Religion to serve as the doctrinal standard for the new church. Those Articles of Religion are still included in our United Methodist Book of Discipline. Article 6 is related to the sufficiency of Scripture, and it made clear that Scripture contains all that one needs to know for salvation. Scripture is sufficient because it does not need to be supplemented by any other revelation. This affirmation is rooted in the Protestant tradition that preceded Methodism and counters the idea that we have to depend on other sources or authorities for salvation. Holding this view does not mean that Scripture is our only source of knowledge for everything. We can still learn new things about the world and about the historical situation in which the Bible was written. And this knowledge helps us to interpret these scriptures. But we can trust that what the Bible does, that Bible does not lack anything that we need in order to know and love God. Welcome to worship in the Bordiner United Methodist Church this morning, where we will continue to read and follow God's holy word as we worship together. You might consider bringing a Bible to worship, or at least reading it daily, as we celebrate God's presence with us, whether we're here in church or at home. Announcements. If you look on the back table, you'll find some Easter eggs. Our purpose is that you would take them home with you and put your spare change in there. Lisa has made us a nice little sign that explains how much money being sent to the Heifer Project is required in order to generate a goat, a chicken, or a number of chicken, or a cow. Our goal is to collect those eggs on Easter Sunday, and we'll send whatever money is in them to the Heifer Project so that we can be a part of this effort, worldwide effort, to help people in need grow their own food. And if you look on page 12 of your bulletin, you'll see most of our schedule for the month of March. The item I'd like to bring to your attention is that in that 2 weeks from today is St. Patrick's Day, and Jesse's Irish Dancers will be joining us for worship that morning. This is always a special worship service. So wear your green, invite your friends and neighbors, because it's always such a wonderful experience. And don't forget to set your clocks ahead next Saturday, because daylight savings time returns. If you don't change your clock, you'll be here an hour early. You can help me set up in that case. The verse I want to bring to your attention this morning is John chapter 2, verse 16. That would be Jesus, told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace."
Thank you.
the Spirit of the Lord is, there is the one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare.
We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good.
We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man,
creator of the Father's unfailing grace,
the ground of our hope, and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truth of Christ and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love, as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, our guide and guardian, you led us apart from the busy world into the quiet of your house. Grant us grace to worship you in spirit and in truth, to comfort our souls in the upbuilding of every good purpose and holy desire. Enable us to do perfectly the work to which you have called us, that we may not fear the coming of night, when we shall resign into your hands the tasks which you have committed to us. So may we worship not with our lips at this hour, but in word and deed all the days of our lives, through Jesus Christ our Savior.
Amen.
And our next hymn is number 559 in the hymnal, Christ Has Made the Sure Foundation.
1 through 17. Then God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I am the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of their parents to the third and the fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you, your son, or your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox, or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. And then we have this epistle from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and the discernment of the discerning. I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided through the foolishness of our proclamation to save those who believe. For Jews ask for signs and Greeks desire wisdom, but we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God, for God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. And today's gospel comes from the book of John, chapter 2, verses 13 through 22. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, take these things out of here. Stop making my father's house a marketplace. His disciples remembered that it was written, zeal for your house will consume me. The Jews then said to him, what sign can you show us for doing this? Jesus answered them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. The Jews then said, this temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days? But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Words are very important. I didn't have to tell you that. But if you ask Bing how many words there are in the English language, you get an answer that seems ambiguous. There are approximately 170,000 to 250,000 words in the English language. Maybe the answer to the question is a different question. How many words do speakers of the English language know? That answer is also a bit murky, but according to at least one study, the average 20-year-old native English speaker knows about 42,000 words. In a 2011 interview with the BBC, lexicographer Susie Dent estimated that while an English speaker may know 40,000 words, they only actively use about half of them. Anyway, that's a lot of words. And the words' meanings, or phrases' meaning, changes with our emotions as we use them. Think about that two-word phrase, oh, darn. If you're angry and you don't watch out, it becomes another two-word phrase that violates the fourth commandment by taking the Lord's name in vain. Or, if you're saying, oh, darn, to yourself under your breath, it might help you remember not to forget some important aspect of your life. As Christians, God speaks to us through the scriptures. The Ten Commandments are God's words, revealing His will for our lives. And 1 Corinthians reminds us that God's words and God's ways might seem foolish to many, but they reveal the deepest truths for those who follow Jesus Christ. And as Jesus threw out the money changers, he remembers God's decrees against turning God's house into a marketplace. Early in the Hebrew scriptures, we're told that God felt it was important to give his word to Moses so that it could be shown to the people and give them some basic guidance for living with God and with each other in harmony. Those Ten Commandments are found both here in the book of Exodus and they're repeated again in Deuteronomy chapter 5, verses 6 through 21. They are the most important of all the instructions that God gives at Mount Sinai. your set of expectations from God. And they are the only instructions that speak directly to the people. Yes, God gave other instructions to Moses, and then Moses passed them on to the people. The Ten Commandments included duties for the people to their God, in verses 2 through 7, duties for the people to each other, in verses 12 through 17, and one duty that involves God and humans and non-human creation, that Sabbath commandment that we found in verses 8 through 11. These direct commands have been passed down in variations throughout time, even into the 21st century, where they still form the basic tenets for human interactions with each other, even in the 21st century. God's words were important in Moses' time and in Jesus' time, and even today. So Paul, in his first letter to the Corinthians, uses his words to explain how important God's words are for those new believers. Paul's proclamation that divine wisdom and power are revealed through weak and foolish things, things like Christ's death on the cross, is a major component of what he's trying to teach the Corinthians. Paul says that Christ crucified is foolishness to those who are perishing, to those who can't comprehend God's wisdom when they're thinking with worldly human wisdom. Yet this foolish message that will bring salvation to those who believe in the resurrected Jesus Christ. When Jesus and his disciples go to the temple in Jerusalem, he is offended by what he sees going on there. Maybe he'd been to the temple before. This is the first time that John records his three visits to the temple. But Jesus' words used here, according to John, are, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." He seems pretty angry. I'm not used to seeing that angry Jesus Christ. What was making him angry? Was it greed? Or cheating the poor? Or was it just the transactional nature of the business that was being conducted in the temple? Probably that's what got Jesus all worked up. We might think it doesn't matter, in which case we read wrong. Jesus' actions in the temple speak louder than his words. John doesn't tell us that he used that whip that he made, but the picture makes it clear that he at least threatened the people. Would Jesus turn over the tables of a modern-day youth group selling tickets to a spaghetti supper on Valentine's Day? Would the mission team be in trouble for offering the 10,000 villages items or handmade bags from Guatemala for sale in Fellowship Hall? Of course not. Jesus wouldn't turn over those tables. He wouldn't turn over those tables whose purpose is to help others in the world. Jesus was angry because the sellers and money changers were taking advantage of other people solely to line their own pockets. That makes most of us mad too, and it led to his display of anger. Now, when Jesus was challenged over his actions, he had an interesting response. John tells us that the leaders of the Jewish people and the temple, he calls them Jews, which is a code word in the gospel for the officials. John never attempts to lump the whole people of Judaism into one statement. So the Jews came to Jesus and said, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" We, like them, might have been shouting at him, or pulling out our hair, what little we have, or calling the police. But instead of that, they just approached Jesus and asked for his credentials. They wanted to see his prophetic credentials, his divine spark, perhaps. What sign, they asked him, can you say, says you can, what sign, they asked him, says you can get away with such outrageous actions? And Jesus' words are telling. Destroy this temple, and I'll raise it up in 3 days, he answers. In John's gospel, Jesus talks in more layers than an onion. And whether it's Nicodemus a little bit later in this chapter, or the woman at the well, or this pack of leaders wanting credentials, it's hard to discern what Jesus is talking about. Standing in the temple, he says, destroy this temple. So you can't blame them for going literal, because it took 46 years to get it where it was. But John's words tell his readers that Jesus was predicting his own death and resurrection in verse 21. He was moving from their building to his earthly body, from a human structure to a sacred being, from that thing to a person who is there, that is the divine presence in that moment. Sadly, Jesus' strong words went right over the heads of the Jewish officials, but his disciples would remember them, and they would recall him at his resurrection. Words are the key for us as well. Our words must be about resurrection, just as Jesus' word. We are being raised up as we gather, as we sing, as we pray, and as we commune together around the word and the sacrament. So we're asking the question about what do we do when we gather? What will be raised up? What will honor God and lift people into God's presence when we come together as the body of Christ? What words might detract or demean and should therefore be avoided? And what words elevate and gather us in where we need to be? Our world has a lot more words than Jesus's did in the first century. We live in a world where words can destroy others and ourselves, both in body and in soul. If we are to stand against that which tears down, we need to consider carefully our words are building up our faith and the faith of others that we present them to. Here in this 2024 Lenten season, as we share the bread and the cup, we're looking forward to Christ's resurrection, and we're looking forward to use our words so that we might be raised up with him and spread the good news of Jesus Christ to others in the world. Amen. you join me then for our unison prayer, which is found printed in your bulletin? Holy God, in Jesus Christ you have built for us an eternal house, a temple of righteousness, a place of gracious plenty for the hungry, and abundant life for the poor in spirit. Fill us with zeal for the body of Christ. Overturn the tables of corruption and greed, and upset the imbalance of justice, so that we may worship you in spirit and in truth. Through Jesus Christ, who is risen indeed. Amen. Would you continue with me in the meditation? Holy God, giver of many words, thank you that you love the world so much you offered your Son for our salvation. We thank you for the words which help us to communicate your love for us and for our neighbors when we use them. We would ask your special care for those we have included in our prayers this morning. Comfort for Mark's family and for the Wheeler family as they deal with the loss of loved ones. Healing prayers for Betsy's brother-in-law and William Chafee, and prayers of thanks for him, the Red and Gray's friend. Hold all who struggle with illness and other physical problems in the palm of your hand, and guide and direct us as we reach out to the world with words of love, so that all may know of you and your love and care for all people. We pause now for a few moments of silent prayer to bring our personal concerns directly to God's ears. We love you. Draw us ever closer to you, to one another, and to the beauty of your wisdom and your love through your word. All these things we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, and our Savior. Amen. And our last hymn is number 624 in the hymnal. Right forward.
Thank you.
let's fill my cup, Lord, number 641 in your hymnal.